The Monk Who Sold His Ferrari. Chapter 1. The vicar called. He collapsed right in the middle of a packed courtroom. He was one of this country's most distinguished trial lawyers. He was also a man who was as well known for the $3,000 Italian suits which draped his well-fed frame as for his remarkable string of legal victories. I simply stood there, paralyzed by the shock of what I had just witnessed. The great Julian Mantle had been reduced to a victim and was now squirming on the ground like a helpless infant, shaking and shivering and sweating like a maniac. Everything seemed to move in slow motion from that point on. My God, Julian's in trouble, his paralegal screamed emotionally, offering us a blinding glimpse of the obvious. The judge looked panic-stricken and quickly muttered something into the private phone she had had installed in the event of an emergency. As for me, I could only stand there, dazed and confused. Please don't die, you old fool. It's too early for you to check out. You don't deserve to die like this. The bailiff, who earlier had looked as if he had been embalmed in his standing position, leaped into action and started to perform CPR on the fallen legal hero. The paralegal was at his side, her long blonde curls dangling over Julian's ruby-red face, offering him soft words of comfort, words which he obviously could not hear. I had known Julian for 17 years. We had first met when I was a young law student, hired by one of his partners as a summer research intern. Back then, he had had it all. He was a brilliant, handsome, and fearless trial attorney with dreams of greatness. Julian was the firm's young star, the rainmaker in waiting. I can still remember walking by his regal corner office while I was working late on one night and stealing a glimpse of the framed quotation perched on his massive oak desk. It was by Winston Churchill, and it spoke volumes about the man that Julian was. Sure I am that this day we are masters of our fate, that the task which has been set before us is not above our strength, that its pangs and toils are not beyond my endurance, as long as we have faith in our own cause and an incurable will to win. Victory will not be denied us. Julian also walked his talk. He was tough, hard driving, and willing to work 18 hours days for the success he believed was his destiny. I heard through the grapevine that his grandfather had been a prominent senator and his father a highly respected judge of the federal court. It was obvious that he came from money and that there were enormous expectations weighing on his Armani-clad shoulders. I will admit one thing, though. He ran his own race. He was determined to do things his own way, and he loved to put on a show. Julian's outrageous courtroom theatrics regularly made the front pages of the newspapers. The rich and famous flocked to his side whenever they needed a superb legal tactician with an aggressive edge. His extracurricular activities were probably as well known. Late night visits to the city's finest restaurants with sexy young fashion models, or reckless drinking escapades with rowdy band of brokers he called his demolition team, became the staff of legend at the firm. I still can't figure out why he picked me to work with him on that sensational murder case, he was to argue that first summer. Though I had graduated from Harvard Law School, his alma mater, I certainly wasn't the brightest intern at the firm, and my family pedigree reflected on blue blood. My father spent his whole life as a security guard with a local bank after a stint in the Marines. My mother grew up unceremoniously in the Bronx, yet he did pick me over all the others who had been quietly lobbying him for the privilege of being his legal gopher on what became known as the mother of all murder trials. He said he liked my hunger. We won, of course, and the business executive who had been charged with brutally killing his wife was now a free man, or as free as his cluttered conscience would let him be. My own education that summer was a rich one. It was far more than a lesson on how to raise a reasonable doubt where none existed. Any lawyer worth his salt could do that. This was a lesson in the psychology of winning and a rare opportunity to watch a master in action. I soaked it up like a sponge. At Julian's invitation, I stayed on the firm as an associate, and a lasting friendship quickly developed between us. I will admit that he wasn't the easiest lawyer to work with. Serving as his junior was often an exercise in frustration, leading to more than a few late-night shouting matches. It was truly his way or the highway. This man could never be wrong. However, beneath his crusty exterior was a person who clearly cared about people. No matter how busy he was, he would always ask about Jenny, the woman I still call my bride, even though we were married before I went to law school. On finding out from another summer intern that I was in a financial squeeze, Julian arranged for me to receive a generous scholarship. Sure, he could play hardball with the best of them, and sure, he loved to have wild time. But he never neglected his friends. The real problem was that Julian was obsessed with work. For the first few years, he justified his long hours by saying that he was doing it for the good of the firm, and that he planned to take a month off and go to the Siemens next winter for sure. As time passed, however, Julian's reputation for brilliance spread and his workload continued to increase. The cases just kept on getting bigger and better, and Julian never won to back down from a good challenge, continued to push himself harder and harder. In his rare moments of quiet, he confided that he could no longer sleep for more than a couple of hours without waking up feeling guilty that he was not working on a file. It soon became clear to me that he was being consumed by the hunger for more, more prestige, more glory, and more money. As expected, Julian became enormously successful. He achieved everything most people could ever want: a stellar professional reputation with an income in seven figures, a spectacular mansion in a neighborhood favored by celebrities, a private jet, a summer home on a tropical island, and his prized possession, a shiny red Ferrari parked in the center of his driveway. Yet I knew that things were not as idyllic as they appeared on the surface. I observed the signs of impending doom, not because I was so much more perceptive than the others at the firm, but simply because I spent the most time with the man. We were always together because we were always at work. Things never seemed to slow down. There was always another blockbuster case on the horizon that was bigger than the last. No amount of preparation was ever enough for Julian. What would happen if the judge brought up this question or that question? God forbid. What would happen if our research was less than perfect? What would happen if he was surprised? in the middle of a packed courtroom, looking like a deer caught in the glare of an intruding pair of headlights. So we pushed ourselves to the limit and I got sucked into his little work center world as well. There we were, two slaves to the clock, toiling away on the 64th floor of some steel and glass monolith. While most sane people were at home with their families, thinking we had the world by the tail, blinded by an illusory version of success. The more time I spent with Julian, the more I could see that he was driving himself deeper into the ground. It was as if he had some kind of a death wish. Nothing ever satisfied him. Eventually, his marriage failed. He no longer spoke with his father, and though he had very material possession anyone could want, he still had not found whatever it was that he was looking for. It showed emotionally, physically, and spiritually. At 53 years of age, Julian looked as if he was in his late 70s. His face was a mass of wrinkles, a less than glorious tribute to his take-no-prisoners approach to life in general and the tremendous stress of his out-of-balance lifestyle in particular. The late-night dinners in expensive French restaurants, smoking thick Cuban cigars and drinking cognac after cognac had left him embarrassingly overweight. He constantly complained that he was sick and tired of being sick and tired. He had lost his sense of humor and never seemed to laugh anymore. Julian's once enthusiastic nature had been replaced by a deathly soberness. Personally, I think that his life had lost all sense of purpose. Perhaps the saddest thing was that he had also lost his focus in the courtroom, where he would once dazzle all those present with an eloquent and airtight closing argument. He now droned on for hours, rambling about obscure cases that had little or no bearing on the matter before the court, where once he would react gracefully to the objections of opposing counsel, he now displayed a biting sarcasm that severely tested the patience of judges who had earlier viewed him as a legal genius. Simply put, Julian's spark of life had begun to flicker. It wasn't just the strain of his frenetic pace that was making him for an early grave. I sensed it went far deeper. It seemed to be a spiritual thing. Almost every day he would tell me that he felt no passion for what he was doing and was enveloped by emptiness. Julian said that as a young lawyer, he really loved the law, even though he was initially pushed into it by the social agenda of his family. The law's complexities and intellectual challenges had kept him spellbound and full of energy. Its power to effect social change had inspired and motivated him. Back then, he was more than just some rich kid from Connecticut. He really saw himself as a force for good, an instrument for social improvement who could use his obvious gifts to help others. That vision gave his life meaning, it gave him a purpose, and it fueled his hopes. There was even more to Julian's undoing than a rusty connection to what he did for a living. He had suffered some great tragedy before I had joined the firm. Something truly unspeakable had happened to him, according to one of the senior partners. But I couldn't get anyone to open up about it. Even old men, Harding, the notoriously loose-lived managing partner who spent more time in the bar of the Ritz-Carlton than in his embarrassingly large office, said that he was sworn to secrecy. Whatever his this deep, darkest secret was, I had a suspicion that it in some way was contributing to Julian's downward spiral. Sure, I was curious, but most of all, I wanted to help him. He was not only my mentor, He was my best friend. And then it happened, this massive heart attack that brought the brilliant Julian Manuel back down to earth and reconnected him to his mortality. Right in the middle of courtroom number 7 on a Monday morning. The same courtroom where we had won the mother of all murder trials. Chapter 2, The Mysterious Visitor. It was an emergency meeting of all of the firm's members as we squeezed into the main boardroom. I could tell that there was a serious problem. Old man Harding was the first to speak to the assembled mass. I am afraid I have some very bad news. Julian Manuel suffered a severe heart attack in court yesterday. While he was arguing the Air Atlantic case, he is currently in the intensive care unit, but his physicians have informed me that his condition has now stabilized and he will recover. However, Julian has made a decision, one that I think you all must know. He has decided to leave our family and to give up his law practice. He will not be returning to the firm. I was shocked. I knew he was having his share of troubles, but I never thought he would quit. As well, after all that we had been through, I thought he should have had the courtesy to tell me this personally. He would not even let me see him at the hospital. Every time I dropped by, the nurses had been instructed to tell me that he was sleeping and could not be disturbed. He even refused to take my telephone calls. Maybe I reminded him of the life he wanted to forget. Who knows? I will tell you one thing, though. It hurt. That whole episode was just over 3 years ago. Last I heard, Julian had headed off to India on some kind of an expedition. He told one of the partners that he wanted to simplify his life and that he needed some answers, and hoped he would find them in that mystical land. He had sold his mansion, his plane, and his private island. He had even sold his Ferrari. Julian Manuel, as an Indian yogi, I thought, the law works in the most mysterious of ways. As those 3 years passed, I changed from an overworked young lawyer to a jaded, somewhat cynical old lawyer. My wife Jenny and I had a family. Eventually, I began my own search for meaning. I think it was having kids that did it. They fundamentally changed the way I saw the world and my role in it. My dad said it best when he said, "John, on your deathbed, you will never wish you spend more time at the office." So I started spending a little more time at home. I settled into a pretty good, if ordinary, existence. I joined the Rotary Club and played golf on Saturdays to keep my partners and clients happy. But I must tell you, in my quiet moments, I often thought of Julian and wondered what had become of him in these years since we had unexpectedly parted company. Perhaps he had settled down in India, a place so diverse that even a restless soul like his could have made it his home. Or maybe he was trekking through Nepal, scuba diving off the Caymans. One thing was certain, he had not returned to the legal profession. No one had received even a postcard from him since he left for his self-imposed exile from the law. A knock on my door about 2 months ago offered the first answers to some of my questions. I had just met with my lost client of a grueling day when Genevieve, my brainy legal assistant, popped her head into my small, elegantly furnished office. "There's someone here to see you, John. He says it's urgent and that he will not leave until he speaks with you." I am on my way out the door. "Genevieve," I replied impatiently. "I am going to grab a bite to eat before finishing off the Hamilton brief. I don't have time to see anyone right now. Tell him to make an appointment like everyone else and call security if he gives you any more trouble. But he says he really needs to see you. He refuses to take no for an answer. For an instant, I considered calling security myself, but realizing that this might be someone in need, I assumed a more forgiving posture. Okay, send him in. I retreated. I probably could use the business anyway. The door to my office opened slowly. At last, it swung fully open, revealing a smiling man in his mid-30s. He was tall, lean, and muscular, radiating an abundance of vitality and energy. He reminded me of those perfect kids I went to law school with, from perfect families with perfect houses, perfect cars, and perfect skin. But there was more to my visitor than his youthful good looks. An underlying peacefulness gave him an almost divine presence. And his eyes, piercing blue eyes that sliced clear through me like a razor meeting the supple flesh of a fresh-faced adolescent anxious about his first shave. Another hot-shot lawyer gunning for my job, I thought to myself, good grief. Why is he just standing there looking at me? I hope that wasn't his wife I represented on that big divorce case I won last week. Maybe calling security wasn't such a silly idea after all. The young man continued to look at me, much as the smiling Buddha might have looked upon a favored pupil. After a long moment of uncomfortable silence, he spoke in a surprisingly commanding tone. Is this how you treat all of your visitors, John? Even those who taught you everything you know about the science of success in a courtroom? I should have kept my trade secrets to myself, he said, his lips curving into a mighty grin. A strange sensation tickled the pit of my stomach. I immediately recognized that raspy, honey smooth voice. My heart started to pound. Julian, is that you? I can't believe it. Is that really you? The old laugh of the visitor confirmed my suspicions. The young man standing before me was none other than the long-lost yogi of India, Julian Manal. I was dazzled by his incredible transformation. Gone was the ghost-like complexion, the sickly cuff, and the lifeless eyes of my former colleague. Gone was the elderly appearance and the morbid expression that had become his personal trademark. Instead, the man in front of me appeared to be in peak health, his lifeless face glowing radiantly. His eyes were bright, offering a window into his extraordinary vitality. Perhaps even more astounding was the serenity that Julian exuded. I felt entirely peaceful there, just sitting there staring at him. He was no longer an anxious type, a senior partner of a leading law firm. Instead, the man before me was a youthful, vital, and smiling model of change. The miraculous transformation of Julian Manal. I was astonished by the new and improved Julian Manal. How could someone who looked like a tired old man only a few short years ago now look so vibrant and alive? I wondered in silent disbelief, was it some magical drug that had allowed him to drink from the fountain of youth? What was the cause of this extraordinary reversal? Julian was the first to speak. He told me that the hyper-competitive legal world had taken its toll on him, not only physically and emotionally, but spiritually. The fast pace and endless demands had worn him out and run him down. He admitted that his body had fallen apart and that his mind had lost its luster. His heart attack was only one symptom of a deeper problem. The constant pressure and exhausting schedule of a world-class trial lawyer had also broken his most important and perhaps most human endowment, his spirit. When given the ultimatum by his doctor, either to give up the law or give up his life, he said he saw a golden opportunity to rekindle the inner fire he had known when he was younger, a fire that had been extinguished as the law became less a player and more a business. Julian grew visibly excited as he recounted how he sold all his material possessions and headed for India, a land whose ancient culture and mystical traditions had always fascinated him. He traveled from tiny village to tiny village, sometimes by foot, sometimes by train, learning new customs, seeing the timeless sights, and growing to love the Indian people who radiated warmth, kindness, and a refreshing perspective on the true meaning of life. Even those who had very little opened their homes and their hearts to this very visitor from the West as the days melted into weeks. Within this enchanting environment, Julian slowly began to feel alive and whole again, perhaps for the first time since he was a child. His natural curiosity and creative spark steadily returned, along with his enthusiasm and his energy for living. He started to feel more joyful and peaceful, and he began to laugh again. Although he embraced every moment of his time in this toxic land, exotic land, Julian told me that his journey to India was more than a simple vacation to ease an overworked mind. He described his time in this faraway land as a personal odyssey of the self. He confided that he was determined to find out who he really was and what his life was all about before it was too late. To do this, his first priority was to connect to that culture's vast pool of ancient wisdom on living a more rewarding, fulfilling, and enlightened life. I don't mean to sound too off the wall, John, but it was like I had received a command from within. An inner instruction telling me that I was to begin a spiritual voyage to rekindle the spark that I had lost, said Julian. It was a tremendously liberating time for me. The more he explored, the more he heard of Indian monks who had lived beyond the age of 100, monks who, despite their advanced years, maintained youthful, energetic, and vital lives. The more he traveled, the more he learned of ageless yogis who had mastered the art of mind control and spiritual awakening, and the more he saw, the more he longed to understand the dynamics behind these miracles of human nature, hoping to apply their philosophies to their own life. During the early stages of his journey, Julian sought out many well-known and highly respected teachers. He told me that each one of them welcomed him with open arms and open hearts, sharing whatever gems of knowledge they had absorbed over lifetimes spent in quiet contemplation on the loftier issues surrounding their existence. Julian also attempted to describe the beauty of the ancient temples which were strewn across the mystical landscape of India, edifices which stood as loyal gatekeepers to the wisdom of the ages. He said he was moved by the sacredness of these surroundings. It was a very magical time of my life, John. Here I was, a tired old litigator who had sold everything from my racehorse to my Rolex and had packed all that remained into a large rucksack that would be my constant companion as I ventured into the timeless traditions of the East. Was it hard to leave? I wondered aloud, unable to contain my curiosity. Actually, it was the easiest thing I have ever done. The decision to give up my practice and all my worldly possessions felt natural. Albert Camus once said that real generosity toward the future consists in giving all to what is present. Well, that's exactly what I did. I knew I had to change, so I decided to listen to my heart and do it in a very dramatic way. My life became so much simpler and meaningful when I left the baggage of my past behind. The moment I stopped spending so much time chasing the big players of life, I began to enjoy the little ones, like watching the stars dancing in a moonlit sky or soaking in the sunbeams of a glorious summer morning. And India is such an intellectually stimulating place that I rarely thought of all I had left. Those initial meetings with the learned and the scholarly of that exotic culture, though intriguing, did not yield the knowledge for which Julian hungered, the wisdom that he desired, and the practical techniques that he hoped would change the quality of his life continue to elude him in those early days of his odyssey. It was not until Julian had been in India for about 7 months that he had his first real break. It was while he was in Kashmir, an ancient and mystical state that sits sleepily at the foot of the Himalayas, that he had the good fortune to meet a gentleman named Yogi Krishnan. This slight man with a clean shaven head also being a lawyer in his previous incarnation, as he often joked with a toothy grin, fed up with the hectic pace that personifies modern New Delhi, he too gave up his material possessions and retreated to a world of greater simplicity, becoming a caretaker of the village temple. Krishnan said he had come to know himself and his purpose in the larger scheme of life. I was tired of living my life like one long air raid drill. I realized that my mission is to serve others and somehow to contribute to making this world a better place. Now I live to give, he told Julian. I spend my days and nights in this temple, giving an austere but fulfilling life. I share my realizations with all those who come here to pray. I serve those in need. I am not a priest. I am simply a man who has found his soul. Julian informed the lawyer turned yogi of his own story. He spoke of his former life of prominence and privilege. He told Yogi Krishnan of his hunger for wealth and his obsession with work. He revealed with great emotion his inner turmoil and the crisis of spirit he had experienced when the once bright light of his life began to flicker in the winds of an out-of-balance lifestyle. I too have walked this path, my friend. I too have felt the pain you have felt. Yet I have learned that everything happens for a reason, offered Yogi Krishnan sympathetically. Every event has a purpose and every setback its lesson. I have realized that failure, whether of the personal, professional, or even spiritual kind, is essential to personal expansion. It brings inner growth and a whole host of psychic rewards. Never regret your past, rather embrace it as the teacher that it is. After hearing these words, Julian told me that he felt great exaltation. Perhaps in Yogi Krishnan he had found the mentor he was searching for, who better than another former hotshot lawyer who, through his own spiritual odyssey, had found a better way of living to teach him the secrets of creating a life of more balance, enchantment, and delight. I need your help, Krishnan. I need to learn how to build a richer, fuller life. I would be honored to assist you in any way that I can, offer the yogi, but may I give you one suggestion? Sure. For as long as I have been caring for this temple in this little village, I have heard whisperings of a mystical land of sages living high in the Himalayas. Legend has it that they have discovered some sort of system that will profoundly improve the quality of anyone's life. And I don't just mean physically. It is supposed to be a holistic, integrated set of ageless principles and timeless techniques to liberate the potential of the mind, body, and soul. Julian was fascinated. This seemed perfect. Just exactly where do these monks live? No one knows, and I regret that I am too old to start searching, but I will tell you one thing, my friend. Many have tried to find them and many have failed with tragic consequences. The higher reaches of the Himalayas are treacherous beyond compare. Even the most skilled climber is rendered helpless against their natural ravages. But if it is the golden keys to radiant health, lasting happiness and inner fulfillment that you are searching for, I do not have the wisdom you seek, they do. Julia, never one to give up easily, pressed Yogi Krishnan again. Are you certain that you have no idea where they live? All I can tell you is that the locals in this village know them as the great sages of Sivana. In their mythology, Sivana means oasis of enlightenment. These monks are revered as if they are divine in their constitution and influence. If I knew where they could be found, I would be duty bound to tell you, but honestly, I do not know. No one does for that matter. The next morning, as the first rays of the Indian sun danced along the colorful horizon, Julian set out on his trek to the lost land of Sivana. At first, he thought about hiring a Sherpa guide to aid him in his climb through the mountains, but for some strange reason, his instincts told him one journey he would have to make alone. So instead, for perhaps the first time in his life, he shed the shackles of reason and placed his truth in his intuition. He felt he would be safe. He somehow knew he would find what he was looking for. So with visionary zeal, he started to climb. The first few days were easy. Sometimes he would catch up to one of the cheerful citizens of the village below, who happened to be walking on one of the footpaths, perhaps searching for just the right piece of wood for a carving, or seeking the sanctuary that this surreal place offered to all those who dare to venture this high into the heavens. At other times, he hiked alone, using this time to silently reflect on where he had been in this life and where he was now headed. I didn't take long before the village below was nothing more than a tiny speck on this marvelous canvas of natural splendor. The majesty of the snow-capped peaks of the Himalayas made his heart beat faster and, for one long moment, took his breath away. He felt a oneness with his surroundings, a kind of kinship that two old friends might enjoy after many years spent listening to each other's innermost thoughts and laughing at each other's jokes. The fresh mountain air cleared his mind and energized his spirit. Having traveled the world many times over, Julian had thought he had seen it all, but he had never seen beauty like this. The wonders of which he dreamt at that magical time were an exhausted tribute to the symphony of nature. At once he felt joyous, exhilarated, and carefree. It was here, high above the humanity below, that Julian slowly ventured out of the cocoon of the ordinary and began to explore the realm of the extraordinary. I still remember the words that were going through my mind up there, said Julian. I thought that ultimately life is all about choices. One's destiny unfolds according to the choices one makes, and I felt certain that the choice I had made was the right one. I knew my life would never be the same, and that something marvelous, maybe even miraculous, was about to happen to me. It was an amazing awakening. As Julian climbed into the rarefied regions of the Himalayas, he told me that he grew anxious, but it was those good kind of jitters, like the ones I had on prom night or right before an exciting case began and the media was chasing me up the courtroom steps. And even though I didn't have the benefit of a guide or a map, the way was clear, and a thin, lightly traveled path led me higher into the deepest reaches for those mountains. It was like I had some sort of inner compass nudging me gently towards my destination. I don't think I could have stopped climbing even if I had wanted to. Julian was excited, his words spilling out like a gushing mountain stream after the rains. As he traveled for two more days along the route that he prayed would take him to Sivana, Julian's thoughts wandered back to his former life, though he felt entirely liberated from the stress and strain that personified his former world. He did wonder whether he could really spend the rest of his days without the intellectual challenge that the legal profession had offered him since he left Harvard Law School. His thoughts then wandered back to his oak paneled office in a glittering downtown skyscraper and the idyllic summer home he had sold for a pittance. He thought about his old friends with whom he would frequent the finest of restaurants in the most glamorous locales. He also thought about his prized Ferrari and how his heart would soar when he gunned the engine. And all his ferocity sprang to life with a roar. As he ventured deeper into the depths of this mystical place, his reflections of the past were quickly interrupted by the stunning marvels of the moment. It was while he was soaking in the gifts of nature's intelligence that something startling happened. From the corner of his eye, he saw another figure dressed strangely in a long, flowing red robe topped by a dark blue hood, slightly ahead of him on the path. Julian was astonished to see anyone at this isolated spot that had taken him 7 treacherous days to reach, as he was many miles away from any real civilization and still uncertain as to where his ultimate destination of Sivana could be found. He yelled out to his fellow traveler. The figure refused to respond and accelerated his pace along the path they were both climbing, not even giving Julian the courtesy of a backward glance of acknowledgement. Soon the mysterious traveler was running, his red robe dancing gracefully behind him like crisp cotton sheets hanging from a clothesline on a windy autumn day. "Please, friend, I need your help to find Sivana," yelled Julian. "I have been traveling for 7 days with this little food and water. I think I am lost." The figure came to an abrupt stop. Julian approached cautiously while the traveler stood remarkably still and silent. His head did not move, his hands did not move, and his feet kept their place. Julian could see nothing of the face beneath the hood, but was struck by the contents of the small basket in the hands of the traveler. Within the basket was a collection of the most delicate and beautiful flowers Julian had ever seen. The figure clutched the basket tighter as Julian drew nearer, as if to display both a love of these prized possessions and a distrust of this tall westerner about as common to these parts as dew in the desert. Julian gazed at the traveler with an intense curiosity. A quick burst of a sunbeam revealed that it was a man's face under the loosely fitting hood. But Julian had never seen a man quite like this one, though he was at least his own age. There were very striking features of this person which left Julian mesmerized and caused him to simply stop and stare for what seemed like an eternity. His eyes were cat-like and so penetrating that Julian was forced to look away. His olive complexion skin was supple and smooth. His body looked strong and powerful, and though the man's hands gave away the fact that he was not young, he radiated such an abundance of youthfulness and vitality that Julian felt hypnotized by what had appeared before him, much like a child watching the magician at his first magic show. "This must be one of the great sages of Sivana," Julian thought to himself, scarcely able to contain his delight at his discovery. I am Julian Manuel. I have come to learn from the sages of Sivana. Do you know where I might find them? He asked. The man looked thoughtfully at this very visitor from the west. His serenity and peace made him appear angelic and in nature and enlightened in substance. The man spoke softly, almost in a whisper. Why is it that you seek these sages, friend? Sensing that he had indeed found one of the mystical monks who had eluded so many before him, Julian opened his heart and poured out his odyssey to the traveler. He spoke of his former life and of the crisis of spirit he had struggled with, how he had traded his health and his energy for the fleeting reward that his law practice brought him. He spoke of how he had traded the riches of his soul for a fat bank account and the illusory gratification of his live fast, die young lifestyle. And he told him of his travels in mystical India and of his meeting with Yogi Krishnan, the former trial lawyer from New Delhi, who had also given up his former life in his hope of finding Delhi, who had also given up his former life in the hope of finding inner harmony and lasting peace. The traveler remained silent and still. It was not until Julian spoke of his burning, almost obsessive desire to acquire the ancient principles of enlightened living that the man spoke again. Placing an arm on Julian's shoulder, the man said gently, if you truly have a heartfelt desire to learn the wisdom of better way, then it is my duty to help you. I am indeed one of those sages that you have come so far in search of. You are the first person to find us in many years. Congratulations, I admire your tenacity. You must have been quite a lawyer, he offered. He paused as if he was a little uncertain of what to do next, and then went on, if you like, you may come with me as my guest to our temple. It rests in a hidden part of this mountain region, still many hours away from here. My brothers and sisters will welcome you with open arms. We will work together to teach you the ancient principles and strategies that our ancestors have passed down through the sages. Before I take you into our private world and share our collective knowledge for filling your life with more joy, strength, and purpose, I must request one promise from you, requested the sage. Upon learning these timeless truths, you must return to your homeland in the West and share this wisdom with all those who need to hear it. Though we are isolated here in these magical mountains, we are aware of the turmoil your world is in. Good people are losing their way. You must give them the hope that they deserve. More importantly, you must give them the tools to fulfill their dreams. This is all I ask. Julian instantly accepted the sage's terms and promised that he would carry their precious message to the West as the two men moved still higher up the mountain path to the lost village of Sivana. The Indian sun started to set, a fiery red circle slipping into a soft magical slumber. After a long and weary day, Julian told me he has never forgotten the majesty of that moment. Walking with an ageless Indian monk for whom he somehow felt a brotherly love, traveling to a place he had longed to find with all its wonders and many mysteries. This was definitely the most memorable moment of my life, he confided in me. Julian had always believed that life came down to a few key moments. This was one of them, deep inside his soul. He somehow sensed that this was the first moment of the rest of his life, a life soon to be much more than it had ever been. Chapter 4, A Magical Meeting with the Sages of Sivana. After walking for many hours along an intricate series of paths and grassy trails, the two travelers came upon a lusty green valley. On one side of the valley, the snow-capped Himalayas offered their protection like weather-beaten soldiers guarding the place where their generals rested. On the other, a thick forest of pine trees sprouted a perfectly natural tribute to this enchanting fantasy land. The sage looked at Julian and smiled gently. Welcome to the Nirvana of Sivana. The two then descended along another less traveled way and into the thick forest, which formed the floor of the valley. The smell of pine and sandalwood wafted through the cool, crisp mountain air. Julian, now barefoot to ease his etching feet, felt the damp moss under his toes. He was surprised to see richly colored orchids and a host of other lovely flowers dancing among the trees as if rejoicing in the beauty and splendor of this tiny slice of heaven. In the distance, Julian could hear gentle voices, soft and soothing to the ear. He continued to follow the sage without making a sound. After walking for about 15 more minutes, the two men reached a clearing. Before him was a sight that even the worldly wise and really surprised Julian Manuel could never have imagined. A small village made solely out of what appeared to be roses. At the center of the village was a tiny temple, the kind Julian had seen on his trips to Thailand and Nepal. But this temple was made of red, white, and pink flowers held together with long strands of multicolored string and twigs. The little huts which dotted the remaining space appeared to be the austere homes of the sages. These were also made of roses. Julian was speechless. As for the monks who inhabited the village, those who could see looked like Julian's traveling companion, who now revealed that his name was Yogi Raman. He explained that he was the eldest sage of Sivana and the leader of this group. The citizens of this dreamlike colony looked astonishingly youthful and moved with poise and purpose. None of them spoke, choosing instead to respect the tranquility of this place by performing their tasks in silence. The men, who appeared to number only about 10, wore the same red-robed uniform as Yogi Raman and smiled serenely at Julian as he entered their village. Each of them looked calm, healthy, and deeply contented. It was as if the tensions which plague so many of us in our modern world had sensed that they were not welcome at this summit of serenity and moved on to more inviting prospects. Though it had been many years since there had been a new face amongst them, these men were controlled in their reception, offering a simple bow as their greeting to the visitor who had traveled so far to find them. The women were equally impressive in their flowing pink silk saris and with white lotuses adorning their jet black hair. They moved busily through the village with exceptional agility. However, this was not the frantic busyness that pervades the life of people in our society. Instead, there was of the easy, graceful kind with zen-like focus more worked inside the temple. Preparing for what appeared to be festival, others carried firewood and richly embroidered tapestries. All were engaged in productive activity, all appeared to be happy. Ultimately, the faces of the sages of Simana revealed the power of their way of life, even though they were clearly mature adults. Each one of them radiated a childlike quality, their eyes twinkling with the vitality of youth. None of them had wrinkles, none of them had gray hair, none of them looked old. Julian, who could scarcely believe what he was experiencing, was offered a feast of fresh fruits and exotic vegetables, a diet that he would later learn was one of the keys to the treasure trove of ideal health enjoyed by the sages. After the meal, Yogi Raman escorted Julian to his living quarters, a flower-filled hut containing a small bed with an empty journal pad on it. This would be his home for the foreseeable future. Though Julian had never seen anything like this magical world of Sivana, he somehow felt that this had been a homecoming of sorts, a return to a paradise that he had known long ago. Somehow this village of roses was not so foreign to him. His intuition told him that he belonged here, if only for a short period. This would be the place where he would rekindle the fire for living that he had known before the legal profession stole his soul. A sanctuary where his broken spirit would slowly start to heal. And so began Julian's life among the sages of Sivana. A life of simplicity, serenity, and harmony. The best was soon to come. Chapter 5. A spiritual student of the sages. Great dreamers. Dreams are never fulfilled, they are always transcended. Alfred Lord Whitehead. It was now 8 p.m. and I still had to prepare for my court appearance the next day, yet I was fascinated by the experience of this former legal warrior who had dramatically transformed his life after meeting and studying under these marvelous sages from India. How amazing, I thought, and what an extraordinary transformation. I secretly wondered whether the secrets Julian had learned in that far-off mountain hideaway could also elevate the quality of my life and replenish my own sense of wonder for the world we live in. The longer I listened to Julian, the more I came to realize that my own spirit had become rusty. What had happened to the uncommon passion I brought to everything I did when I was younger? Back then, even the simplest of things filled me with a sense of joy. Maybe it was time for me to reinvent my destiny. Sensing my fascination with this odyssey and my eagerness to learn the system of enlightened living that the sages had passed on to him, Julian quickened the pace as he continued with his tale. He told me how his desire for knowledge, coupled with his sharp intellect, refined through many years of battles in the courtroom, had made him a well-loved member of the Sivana community. As a mark of their affection for Julian, the monks eventually made him an honorary member of their band, and treated him like an integral part of their extended family. Eager to expand his knowledge of the workings of the mind, body, and soul, and to attain self-mastery, Julian spent literally every waking moment under the tutelage of Yogi Raman. The sage became more like a father to Julian than a teacher, though they were separated in age by only a few years. It was clear that this man had the accumulated wisdom of many lifetimes, and most happily, he was willing to share it with Julian. Beginning before dawn, Yogi Raman would sit with his enthusiastic student and fill his mind with insights on the meaning of life and little known techniques that he had mastered for living with greater vitality, creativity, and fulfillment. He taught Julian ancient principles which he said anyone could use to live longer, stay younger, and grow far happier. Julian also learned how the twin disciplines of personal mastery and self-responsibility would keep him from returning to the chaos of crisis that had characterized his life in the West. As the weeks slipped into months, he came to understand the treasure trove of potential sleeping within his own mind, waiting to be awakened and used for higher purposes. Sometimes the teacher and his student would simply sit and watch the blazing Indian sun rising from the deep green meadows far below. Sometimes they would walk through the pine forest, discussing points of philosophy and enjoying the pleasures of each other's company. Julian said that the first indications of his personal expansion came after only 3 weeks in Sivana. He started noticing the beauty in the most ordinary of things, whether it was the marvel of a starry night or the enchantment of a spider's web after it had rained. Julian absorbed it all. He also said that his new lifestyle and the new habits associated with it started to have a profound effect on his inner world within a month of applying the principles and techniques of the sages. He told me that he had begun to cultivate the deep sense of peace and inner serenity that had eluded him in all the years he had lived in the West. He became more joyful and spontaneous, growing more energetic and creative with each passing day. Physical vitality and spiritual strength followed the changes in Julian's attitude. His once overweight frame grew strong and lean, while the sickly pallor which had characterized his face was replaced by a splendid shimmer of health. He actually felt as if he could do anything, be anything, and unlock the infinite potential that he learned was inside every one of us. He started to cherish life and to see the divinity in every aspect of it. The ancient system of this mystical band of monks had started to work its miracles. After pausing as if to express disbelief at his own tale, Julian grew philosophical. "I have realized something very important, John. The world, and that indicates my inner world, is a very special place. I have also come to see that success on the outside means nothing unless you also have success within. There is a huge difference between well-being and being well off. When I was a hotshot lawyer, I used to snicker at all those people who worked at improving their inner and outer lives. Get a life, I thought. But I have learned that self-mastery and the consisted care of one's mind, body, and soul are essential to finding one's higher self and living the life of one's dreams. How can you care for others if you cannot even care for yourself? How can you do good if you don't even feel good? I can't love you if I can't love myself," he offered. Suddenly, Julian grew flustered and slightly uneasy. "I have never opened my heart to anyone like this before. I apologize for this, John. It is just that I experienced such a catharsis up in those mountains, such a spiritual awakening to the powers of the universe, that I feel others need to know what I know. Noticing that it was getting late, Julian quickly told me he would take his leave and bid me adieu. You can't leave now, Julian. I am really pumped to hear the wisdom you learned in the Himalayas and the message you promised your teachers you would bring back to the West. You can't leave me in suspense. You know I can't stand it. I will be back, rest assured, my friend. You know me, once I start telling a good story, I just can't stop. But you have your work to do, and I have some private matters that need to be taken care of. Just tell me one thing then. Will the method you learned in Sivana work for me? When the student is ready, the teacher appears, came the swift reply. You, along with so many others in our society, are ready for the wisdom I now have the privilege of holding. Every one of us should know the philosophy of the sages. Every one of us can benefit by it. Every one of us must know of this perfection that is their natural state. I promise I will share their ancient knowledge with you. Have patience. I will meet you again tomorrow night, this time at your house. Then I will tell you all that you need to know to put far more living into your life. Is that fair? Yeah, I guess I have done without it all these years. Waiting another 24 hours won't kill me. I responded with this appointment, and with that the master litigator turned enlightened yogi of the East was gone, leaving me with a mind full of unanswered questions and unfinished thoughts. As I sat in my office quietly, I realized how small our world really was. I thought about the vast pool of knowledge that I had not even begun to dip my fingers into. I thought about how it might feel to regain my own zest for living, and about the curiosity I had had when I was younger. I would love to feel more alive and to bring unbridled energy to my days. Maybe I too would leave the legal profession. Maybe there was a higher calling for me as well. With these weighty considerations on my mind, I turned out the lights, locked the door to my office, and walked out into the thick heat of another summer's night. Chapter 6, The Wisdom of Personal Change. I am an artist at living. My work of art is my life. Suzuki. True to his word, Julian showed up at my home the next evening at about 7:15 p.m. I heard four quick knocks on the front door of my house, a keep court design with awful pink shutters that my wife believed made our house look like something out of Architectural Digest. Julian himself looked strikingly different than he had the day before. He still embodied radiant health and exuded a wonderful sense of calm. It was what he was wearing that made me a little uncomfortable. Adorning his obviously supple body was a long red robe topped by an ornately embroidered blue hood, and though it was another sickly night in July, the hood covered his head. "Greetings, my friend," Julian offered enthusiastically. "Greetings. Don't look so alarmed. What did you expect me to wear, Armani?" We both started to laugh softly at first. Soon our giggles had turned to guffaws. Julian certainly had not lost that wicked sense of humor that had kept me entertained so long ago. As we relaxed in my cluttered but comfortable living room, I couldn't help but notice the ornate necklace of wooden prayer beads dangling from his neck. What are those? They are really beautiful. More about these later, he said, rubbing some of the beads with his thumb and index finger. We have much to talk about tonight. Let's get started. I could hardly get anything done at work today. I was so excited about our meeting. Hearing his cue, Julian immediately started to reveal more about his personal transformation and the ease with which it was effected. He told me of the ancient techniques he had learned for mind control and for erasing the habit of worry that was consuming so many in our complex society. He spoke of the wisdom that Yogi Ramman and the other monks had shared for living a more purposeful and rewarding life. And he spoke of a series of methods to unleash this wellspring of usefulness and energy. He said, every one of us has slumbering deep inside of us. Though the conviction with which he spoke was clear, I began to grow skeptical. Was I the victim of some prank? After all, this Harvard-trained lawyer was once widely known within the firm for his practical jokes. As well, his story was nothing less than fantastic to think about it. One of this country's best known trial lawyers throw in the towel, sells all his worldly goods and treks off to India on a spiritual odyssey, only to return as a wise prophet from the Himalaya. This could not be real. Come on, Julian, stop pulling my leg. This whole story is starting to smack of one of your gags. I will bet you rented that robe from the costume shop across the street from my office. I suggested breaking into my best fair green. Julian was quick to respond, as if my disbelief was something he had expected. In court, how do you prove your case? I offer persuasive evidence. Right, look at the evidence that I have offered you. Look at my smooth, lineless face. Look at my physique. Can't you sense the abundance of energy I have? Look at my peacefulness. Surely you can see that I have changed. He had a point. This was a man who only a few years ago had looked decades older. No, you didn't go to a plastic surgeon, did you? No, he smiled. They only focus on the outer person. I needed to be healed from within. My unbalanced, chaotic lifestyle left me in great distress. It was much more than a heart attack that I suffered. It was a rupture of my inner core. But your story is so mysterious and unusual. Julian remained calm and patient in the face of my persistence. Spotting the pot of tea I had left on the table next to him, he started to pour into my waiting cup. He poured until the cup was full, but then he kept on pouring. Tea started to trickle down the sides of the cup and into the saucer, then onto my wife's prized Persian rug. At first I watched silently, then I couldn't take it any more. Julian, what are you doing? My cup is overflowing. No matter how hard you try, no more will go in, I yelled impatiently. He looked at me for a long moment. Please don't take this the wrong way. I really respect you, John. I always have, however. Just like this cup, you seem to be full of your own ideas, and how can any more go in until you first empty your cup? I was struck by the truth of his words. He was right. My many years in the conservative legal world doing the same things every day with the same people who thought the same thoughts every day had filled my cup to the brim. My wife Jenny was always telling me that we should be meeting new people and exploring new things. I wish you were just a little more adventurous, John, she would say. I couldn't remember the last time I had read a book that didn't deal with law. The profession was my life. I began to realize that the sterile world I had grown accustomed to had dulled my creativity and limited my vision. Okay, I see your point, I admitted. Perhaps all my years as a trial lawyer have made me a hardened skeptic. From the minute I saw you in my office yesterday, something deep inside me told me that your transformation was genuine and that there was some sort of lesson in it for me. Maybe I just didn't want to believe it. John, tonight is the first night of your new life. I simply ask that you think deeply about the wisdom and strategies that I will share with you and apply them with conviction for a period of 1 month. Embrace the methods with a deep trust in their effectiveness. There is a reason why they have survived for thousands of years. They work. 1 month seems like a long time. 622 hours of inner work to profoundly improve every waking moment of the rest of your life. It's quite a bargain. Don't you think investing in yourself is the best investment you will ever make? It will not only improve your life, it will improve the lives of all those around you. How's that? It is only when you have mastered the art of loving yourself that you can truly love others. It's only when you have opened your own heart that you can touch the hearts of others. When you feel centered and alive, you are in a much better position to be a better person. What can I expect to happen in those 622 hours that comprise 1 month? I asked earnestly. You will experience changes within the workings of your mind, body, and even your soul that you will astonish. You will have more energy, enthusiasm, and inner harmony than you have had in perhaps your entire life. People will actually begin telling you that you look younger and happier. A lasting sense of well-being and balance will swiftly return to your life. These are just some of the benefits of the Sivanan system. Wow, all of what you will hear tonight is designed to improve your life, not just personally and professionally, but spiritually as well. The advice of the sages is just as current today as it was 5,000 years ago. It will not only enrich your inner world, it will enhance your outer world and make you far more effective in all that you do. This wisdom is truly the most potent force I have ever encountered. It is straightforward, practical, and has been tested in the laboratory for life for centuries. Most importantly, it will work for anyone. But before I share this knowledge with you, I must ask you for a promise. I knew there would be strings attached. There are no free lunches, my loving mother used to say. Once you see the power of the strategies and skills shown to me by the sages of Sivana and observe the dramatic results they will bring to your life, you must take it your mission to pass this wisdom on to others who will benefit from this knowledge. This is all that I ask of you. By agreeing to this, you will help me fulfill my own pact with Yogi Raman. I agreed without reservation. Julian began to teach me the system he had come to consider as sacred. While the techniques that Julian had mastered during his stay were varied, at the heart of the Sivanand system were seven basic virtues, seven fundamental principles which embodied the keys to self-leadership, personal responsibility, and spiritual enlightenment. Julian told me that Yogi Raman was the first to share the seven virtues with him. After a few months in Simana, on a clear night when all the others had drifted off into deep slumber, Raman knocked softly on the door of Julian's hut. In the voice of a gentle guide, he spoke his mind. "I have observed you closely for many days now, Julian. I believe that you are a decent man who deeply desires to fill his life with all that is good. Since you have arrived, you have opened yourself up to our traditions and embraced them as your own. You have learned a number of our daily habits and have seen their many salutary effects. You have been respectful of our ways. Our people have lived this simple, peaceful life through countless ages. And our methods are known to but a few. The world needs to hear our philosophy on enlightened living. Tonight, on the eve of your third month in Simana, I will begin to share the inner workings of our system with you, not only for your benefit, but for the benefit of all those in your part of the world. I will sit with you daily, as I sat with my son when he was a child. Sadly, he passed on a few years ago. His time had come, and I do not question his existence. I enjoyed our time together and cherished the memories. I now see you as my son, and I feel grateful that all I have learned over many years of silent contemplation will live on within you. I looked at Julian and noticed that his eyes were now shut, as if he were transporting himself back to this fairy tale land that had showered the blessings of knowledge on him. Yogi Raman told me that the seven virtues for a life overflowing with inner peace, joy, and a wealth of spiritual gifts were contained within a mystical fable. This fable was the essence of it all. He asked me to shut my eyes, as I have now done here on the floor of your living room. He then told me to picture the following scene in my mind's eye. You are sitting in the middle of a magnificent lush green garden. This garden is filled with the most spectacular flowers you have ever seen. The environment is supremely tranquil and silent. Savor the sensual delights of this garden and feel as if you have all the time in the world to enjoy this natural oasis. As you look around, you see that in the center of this magical garden stands a towering red lighthouse 6 stories high. Suddenly, the silence of the garden is disturbed by a loud creaking as the door at the base of the lighthouse opens. Out stumbles a 9-foot-tall, 900-pound Japanese sumo wrestler who casually wanders into the center of the garden. "It gets better," chuckled Julian. "The Japanese sumo wrestler is naked." "Well, actually, he is not totally naked. He has a pink wire cable covering his private parts." As this sumo wrestler starts to move around the garden, he finds a shiny gold stopwatch which someone had left behind many years earlier. He slips it on and falls to the ground with an enormous thud. The sumo wrestler is rendered unconscious and lies there, silent and still. Just when you think he has taken his last breath, The wrestler awakens, perhaps stirred by the fragrance of some fresh yellow roses blooming nearby. Energized, the wrestler jumps swiftly to his feet and intuitively looks to his left. He is startled as what he sees through the bushes at the very edge of the garden he observes. A long winding path covered by millions of sparkling diamonds. Something seems to instruct the wrestler to take the path, and to his credit, he does. This path leads him down the road of everlasting joy and eternal bliss. After hearing this strange tale, high atop the Himalayas, seated next to a monk who had seen the torchlight of enlightenment firsthand, Julian told me that he was disappointed. Quite simply, he said that he thought he was going to hear something earth-shattering, knowledge that would stir him to action, perhaps even more him to tears. Instead, all he heard was a silly story about a sumo wrestler and a lighthouse. Yogi Ramon detected his dismay. Never overlook the power of simplicity, Julian was told. This story may not be the sophisticated discourse that you expected, said the sage, but there is a universe of sensibility in its message and purity in its purpose from the day you arrived. I have thought long and hard as to how I would share our knowledge with you. At first, I considered giving you a series of lectures over a period of months, but realized that this traditional approach was ill-suited to the magical nature of the wisdom you are about to receive. I then thought of asking all of my brothers and sisters to spend a time when you every day tutoring you into our philosophy. However, this too was not the most effective way for you to learn what it is we have to tell. After great deliberation, I finally arrived at what I thought was a very creative yet highly effective way to share the entire system of Sivana with its seven virtues, and that is this mystical fable. The sage added, at first it might seem to be frivolous and perhaps even childish, but I assure you that every element of the fable embodies a timeless principle of radiant living and has great depth of meaning. The garden, the lighthouse, the sumo wrestler, the pink wire cable, the stopwatch, the roses and winding path of diamonds are symbols of the seven timeless virtues for an enlightened life. I can also assure you that if you remember this little story and the fundamental truths that it represents, you will carry within you all that you need to know to raise your life to its highest level. You will have all the information and strategies you will need to profoundly influence the quality of your life and the lives of all those you touch. And when you apply this wisdom on a daily basis, you will change mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Please write this story deep into your mind and carry it within your heart. It will only make a dramatic difference to you. If you embrace it without reservation. Luckily, John said, Julian, I did embrace it. Carl Jung once said that your vision will become clear only when you can look into your heart. Who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakens. On that very special night, I looked deep into my heart and awakened to the secrets of the ages of for enriching the mind. Cultivating the body and nourishing the soul, it is now my turn to share them with you.
Chapter 7, A Most Extraordinary Garden. Most people live, whether physically, intellectually, or morally, in a very restricted circle of their potential being, We all have reservoirs of life to draw upon of which we do not dream. William James. In the fable, the garden is a symbol for the mind, said Julian, if you care for your mind. If you nurture it and if you cultivate it just like a fertile, rich garden, it will blossom far beyond your expectations. But if you let the weeds take root, lasting peace of mind and deeper inner harmony will always elude you. John, let me ask you a simple question. If I went into your backyard where you have that garden you used to tell me so much about and threw toxic waste over all your prized petunias, you wouldn't be thrilled, would you? Agreed. As a matter of fact, most good gardeners guard their gardens like proud soldiers and make certain that no contamination ever enters. Yet look at the toxic waste that most people put into the fertile garden of their minds every single day. The worries and anxieties, the fretting about the past, the brooding over the future, and those self-created fears that wreak havoc within your inner world. In the native language of the sages of Sivana, which has existed for thousands of years, the written character for worry is strikingly similar to the character symbolizing a funeral pyre. Yogi Raman told me that this was no mere coincidence. Worry drains the mind of much of its power, and sooner or later it injures the soul. To live life to the fullest, you must stand guard at the gate of your garden and let only the very best information enter. You truly cannot afford the luxury of a negative thought, not even one. The most joyful, dynamic, and contented people of this world are no different from you or me in terms of their makeup. We are all flesh and bones. We all come from the same universal source. However, the ones who do more than just exist, the ones who fan the flames of their human potential and truly savor the magical dance of life, do things, different things than those whose lives are ordinary. Foremost amongst the things that they do is adopt a positive paradigm about their world and all that is in it. Julian added, the sages taught me that on an average day, the average person runs about 60,000 thoughts through his mind. What really amazed me though was that 95% of those thoughts were the same as the ones you thought the day before. Are you serious? I asked. Very, this is the tyranny of impoverished thinking, those people who think the same thoughts every day. Most of them negative have fallen into bad mental habits rather than focusing on all the good in their lives and thinking of ways to make things even better. They are captives of their past. Some of them worry about failed relationships or financial problems. Others fret over their less than perfect childhoods. Still others brood over more trifling matters, the way a store clerk might have treated them, or the comment of a co-worker that smacked of ill will. Those who run their minds in this fashion are allowing worry to rob them of their life force. They are blocking the enormous potential of their minds to work magic and deliver into their lives all that they want emotionally, physically, and yes, even spiritually. These people never realize that mind management is the essence of life management. The way you think stems from habit, pure and simple. Julian continued with conviction, most people just don't realize the enormous power of their minds. I have learned that even the best conditioned thinkers are using only 1/100th of a percent of their mental reserves. In Sivana, the sages dare to explore the untapped potential for their mental capacity on a regular basis, and the results were astounding. Yogi Raman, through regular and disciplined practice, had conditioned his mind so that he was able to slow down his heartbeat at will. He had even trained himself to go for weeks without sleep, while I would never suggest that these should be goals for you to aspire to. I do suggest that you start to see your mind for what it is, nature's greatest gift. Are there some exercises I can do to unlock this mind power? Being able to slow down my heartbeat would definitely make me a hit on the cocktail party circuit, I suggested cheekily. Don't worry about that now, John. I will give you some practical techniques that you can try later that will show you the power of this ancient technology. For now, what is important is that you understand and that mental mastery comes through conditioning, nothing more and nothing less. Most of us have the same raw materials from the moment we take our first breath of air. What separates those people who achieve more than others or those that are happier than others is the way that they use and refine these raw materials. When you dedicate yourself to transforming your inner world, your life quickly shifts from the ordinary into the realm of the extraordinary. My teacher was growing more excited by the moment. His eyes seemed to twinkle as he spoke of the magic of the mind and the wealth of goodness it would surely bring. You know, John, when all is said and done, there is only one thing that we have absolute dominion over. Our kids, I said, smiling good-naturedly. No, my friend, our minds, we might not be able to control the weather or the traffic or the moods of all those around us, but we most certainly can control our attitude towards these events. We all have the power to determine what we will think about in any given moment. This ability is part of what makes us human. You see, one of the fundamental gems of worldly wisdom I have learned in my travels to the East is also one of the most simple. Julian then paused as if to summon up a priceless gift, and what might that be? There is no such thing as objective reality or the real world. There are no absolutes. The face of your greatest enemy might be the face of my finest friend. An event that appears to be a tragedy to one might reveal the seeds of unlimited opportunity to another. What really separates people who are habitually upbeat and optimistic from those who are consistently miserable is how the circumstances of life are interpreted and processed. John, how could tragedy be anything but tragedy? Here's a quick example. When I was traveling through Calcutta, I met a school teacher named Malika Chand. She loved teaching and treated her students as she would her own children, nurturing their potential with great kindness. Her perennial motto was, "Your IQ is more important than your IQ." She was known throughout her community as a person who lived to give, who selflessly served anyone in need. Sadly, her beloved school, which had stood as a silent witness to the delightful progress of generations of children, succumbed to the flames of a fire set by an arsonist one night. All those in the community felt this great loss, but as time passed, their anger gave way to apathy and they resigned themselves to the fact that their children would be without a school. What about Malika? She was different and eternal optimist if there ever was one. Unlike everyone around her, she perceived opportunity in what had happened. She told all the parents that every setback offers an equivalent benefit if they took the time to search for it. This event was a gift in disguise. The school that burned to the ground was old and decrepit. The roof leaked and the floor had finally buckled under the strain of a thousand little feet scampering across its surface. This was the chance that they had been waiting for to join hands as a community and build a much better school. One that would serve many more children in the years to come. And so with this 64-year-old dynamo behind them, they marshaled their collective resources and raised enough funds to build a sparkling new school, one that stood as a shining example of the power of vision in the face of adversity. So it's like that old adage about seeing the cup as half full rather than half empty. That's a fair way to look at it. No matter what happens to you in your life, you alone have the capacity to choose your response to it. When you form the habit of searching for the positive in every circumstance, your life will move into its highest dimensions. This is one of the greatest of all the natural laws, and it all starts with using your mind more effectively. Exactly, John. All success in life, whether material or spiritual, starts with that 12-pound mass sitting between your shoulders, or more specifically with the thoughts that you put into your mind every second of every minute of every day. Your outer world reflects the state of your inner world. By controlling the thoughts that you think and the way you respond to the events of your life, you begin to control your destiny. This makes so much sense, Julian. I guess my life has become so busy that I have never taken the time to think about these things. When I was in law school, my best friend Alex used to love reading inspirational books. He said that they kept him motivated and energized in the face of our crushing workload. I remember him telling me that one of them said that the Chinese character for crisis is compromise of two sub-characters, one that spells danger and another that spells opportunity. I guess that even the ancient Chinese knew that there is a bright side to the darkest circumstance if you have the courage to look for it. Yogi Raman put it this way: there are no mistakes in life, only lessons. There is no such thing as a negative experience, only opportunities to grow, learn, and advance along the road of self-mastery. From struggle comes strength. Every pain can be a wonderful teacher. Pain, I protested. Absolutely. To understand pain, you must first experience it. Or to put it another way, how can you really know the joy of being on the summit of the mountain unless you have first visited the lowest valley? Get my point. To savor the good, one must know the bad. Yes, but I suggest that you stop judging events as either positive or negative. Rather, simply experience them. Celebrate them and learn from them. Every event offers you lessons. These little lessons fuel your inner and outer growth. Without them, you would be stuck on a plateau. Just think about it in your own life. Most people have grown the most from their most challenging experiences, and if you meet with an outcome you did not expect and feel a little disappointed, remember that the laws of nature always ensure that when one door closes, another opens. Julian started to raise his arms in excitement, much as a southern minister might while preaching to his congregation. Once you consistently apply this principle to your daily life and start to condition your mind to translate every event into a positive, empowering one, you will banish worry forever. You will stop being a prisoner of your past. Instead, you will become the architect of your future. Okay, I understand the concept. Every experience, even the worst, offers me a lesson. Therefore, I should open my mind to the learning in every event. In this way, I will grow stronger and happier. What else might a humble middle-class lawyer do to improve things? First of all, begin to live out of the glory of your imagination, not your memory. Run that one by me again. All that I am saying is that to liberate the potential of your mind, body and soul, you must first expand your imagination. You see, things are always created twice, first in the workshop of the mind and then and only then in reality. I call the process blueprinting, because anything that you create in your outer world begin as a simple blueprint in your inner world, on the lush picture screen of your mind. When you learn to take control of your thoughts and vividly imagine all that you desire from this worldly existence in a state of total expectancy, dormant forces will awaken inside you. You will begin to unlock the true potential of your mind to create the kind of magical life that I believe you deserve. From tonight onwards, forget about the past. Dare to dream that you are more than the sum of your current circumstances. Expect the best. You will be astonished at the results. You know, John, all those years in the legal profession, I thought I knew so much. I spent years studying at the finest schools, reading all the law books I could get my hands on, and working with the best role models. Sure, I was a winner at a game of life, yet I have realized I was losing in the game of life. I was so busy chasing the big players of life that I missed out on all the little ones. I never read those great books my father used to tell me to read. I haven't built any great friendships. I have never learned to appreciate great music. Having said this, I really think I am one of the lucky ones. My heart attack was my defining moment, my personal wake-up call, if you will believe it or not. It gave me a second chance to live a richer, more inspired life like Malika Chand. I saw the seeds of opportunity in my painful experience. More importantly, I had the courage to nourish them. I could see that while Julian had grown younger on the outside, he had grown far wiser within. I realized that this evening was more than just a fascinating conversation with an old friend. I realized that tonight could be on defining moment and a clear chance for a new beginning. My mind started to consider all that was wrong in my own life. Sure, I had a great family and a stable job as a well-regarded lawyer, yet in my quiet moments, I knew there had to be more. I had to feel that emptiness that was starting to envelop my life. When I was a kid, I dreamed such great dreams. Often I visualized myself as a sports hero or a business tycoon. I really believed that I could do, have, and be whatever I wanted to be. I also remembered the way I used to feel as a young boy growing up on the sun-splashed West Coast. Fun came in the form of simple pleasures. Fun was spending a glorious afternoon skinny-dipping or riding through the woods on my bicycle. I had such a curiosity for life. I was an adventurer. There were no limits on what my future could bring. I honestly don't think I have felt that kind of freedom and joy for 15 years. What happened? Perhaps I got sight of my dreams when I became an adult and resigned myself to acting the way adults were supposed to act.
When I was a kid, I dreamed such great dreams. Often I visualized myself as a sports hero or a business tycoon. I really believed that I could do, have, and be whatever I wanted to be. I also remembered the way I used to feel as a young boy growing up on the sun-splashed West Coast. Fun came in the form of simple pleasures. Fun was spending a glorious afternoon skinny-dipping or riding through the woods on my bicycle. I had such a curiosity for life. I was an adventurer. There were no limits on what my future could bring. I honestly don't think I have felt that kind of freedom and joy for 15 years. What happened? Perhaps I got sight of my dreams when I became an adult and resigned myself to acting the way adults were supposed to act. Maybe I lost sight of them when I went to law school and starting talking like lawyers were supposed to talk in any event. That evening, with Julian at my side, pouring his heart out over a cup of cold tea, made me resolve to stop spending so much time making a living and to spend far more time creating a life. Looks like I have you thinking about your life also, Julian observed. Start thinking about your dreams for a change, just like when you were a little child. Jonas Salk said it best when he wrote, I have had dreams and I have had nightmares. I overcame the nightmares because of my dreams. Dare to dust off your dreams, Johan. Start to revel life again and celebrate all of its wonders. Awaken yourself to the power of your own mind to make things happen. Once you do, the universe will conspire with you to work magic in your life. Julian then reached into the depths of his robe and pulled out a little card about the size of a business card which had tears along its sides. Apparently the result of many months of constant use, on one day while Jogi Raman and I were walking along a quiet mountain path, I asked him who his favorite philosopher was. He told me that he had many influences in his life, and it was difficult for him to single out any one source for his inspiration. There was one quotation, however, that he carried deep within his heart, one that encapsulated all the values he had come to cherish over a life spent in quiet contemplation. All that glorious place, deep within the middle of nowhere, this learned sage of the East shared it with me. I too etched its words into my heart. They serve as a daily reminder of all that we are and all that we can be. The words came from the great Indian philosopher Patanjali, repeating them aloud. Every morning before I sit down to meditate has had a very profound influence on the course of my day. Remember, John, words are the verbal embodiment of power. Julian then showed me the card. The quotation read, When you are inspired by some great purpose, some extraordinary project, all of your thoughts break their bonds. Your mind transcends limitations. Your conscience expands in every direction and you find yourself in a new, great and wonderful world. Dormant forces, faculties and talents become alive and you discover yourself to be a greater person than you ever dreamed yourself to be. In that instant, I saw the connection between physical vitality and mental agility. Julian was in partnership with perfect health and looked many years younger than he had. When we had first met, he brimmed with vibrancy and it appeared that his energy, enthusiasm and optimism knew no bounds. I could see that he had made many changes to his former lifestyle, but it was obvious that the starting point of his magnificent transformation was mental fitness. Success on the outside indeed begins with success on the inside, and by changing his thoughts, Julian Manuel had changed his life. Exactly how can I develop this positive, serene and inspired attitude, Julian? After all these years in my routine, I think my mental muscles have grown a little flabby. Come to think of it, I have very little control over the thoughts that are floating around the garden of my mind, I said with sincerity. The mind is a wonderful servant but a terrible master. If you have become a negative thinker, this is because you have not cared for your mind and taken the time to train it to focus on the good. Winston Churchill said that the price of greatness is responsibility over each of your thoughts. Then you will install the vibrant mindset you are looking for. Remember, the mind truly is like any other muscle in your body. Use it or lose it. Are you saying that if I don't exercise my mind, it will grow weak? Yes, look at it this way. If you want to strengthen the muscles of your arm, to achieve more, you must train them. If you want to toughen up your leg muscles, you must first exert them. Similarly, your mind will do wonderful things for you if only you will let it. It will attract all that you desire into your life. Once you learn how to operate it effectively, it will create ideal health if you care for it properly, and it will return to its natural state of peacefulness and tranquility if you have the vision to ask for it. The sages of Sivana leave a very special saying: the boundaries of your life are merely creations of the self. I don't think I understand that one, Julian. Enlightened thinkers know that their thoughts form their world, and the quality of one's life comes down to the richness of one's thoughts. If you want to live a more peaceful, meaningful life, you must think more peaceful, meaningful thoughts. Hit me with the quick fix, Julian. What do you mean? Julian asked, gently running his bronzed fingers along the front of his brilliantly textured robe. I am excited about what you are telling me, but I am an impatient guy. Don't you have any exercises or techniques that I can use right now, here in my own living room, to change the way I run my mind? Quick fixes do not work. All lasting inner change requires time and effort. Persistence is the mother of personal change. I am not saying that it will take years to make profound changes in your life if you diligently apply the strategies I am sharing with you every day for only 1 month. You will be astonished at the results. You will begin to tap into the highest levels of your own capacity and enter the realm of miraculous But to reach this destination, you must not get hung up on the outcome. Instead, enjoy the process of personal expansion and growth. Ironically, the less you focus on the end result, the quicker it will come. How so? It's like that classic story of the young boy who traveled far from his home to study under a great teacher. When he met the wise old man, his first question was, "How long will it take me before I am as wise as you?" The response came swiftly, 5 years. This is a very long time. The boy replied, "How about if I work twice as hard, then it will take 10, said the master. 10, that's far too long. How about if I studied all day and well into the night, every night? 15 years, said the sage. "I don't understand," I replied the boy. "Every time I promise to devote more energy to my goal, you tell me that it will take longer. Why?" The answer is simple. With one eye fixed on the destination, there is only one left to guide you along the journey. Put point well taken, counselor, I conceded graciously. Sounds like the story of my life. Be patient and live with the knowledge. All that you are searching for is certain to come if you prepare for it and expect it. But I have never been the lucky sort, Julian. All that I have ever received has come through sheer persistence. What is luck? My friend, Julian replied kindly, it is nothing more than the marriage of preparation with opportunity. Julian added softly, before I give you the precise methods passed on to me by sages of Simana, I must first share a couple of key principles. First, always remember that concentration is at the root of mental mastery. Seriously, I know it surprised me too, but it is true. The mind can accomplish extraordinary things. You have learned this. The very fact that you have a desire or a dream means that you have the corresponding capacity to realize it. This is one of the great universal truths known to the sages of Sivana. However, to liberate the power of the mind, you must first to be able to harness it and direct its focus only to the task at hand. The moment you concentrate the focus of your mind on a singular purpose, extraordinary gifts will appear within your life. Why is it so important to have a concentrated mind? Let me offer you a riddle that will answer your question nicely. Say you were lost in the woods in the middle of the winter. You desperately needed to stay warm. All you have in your knapsack is a letter your best friend had sent to you, a tin of tuna and a small magnifying glass that you carry to compensate for your fading eyesight. Luckily, you managed to find some dry kindling wood, but unfortunately, you have no matches. How would you light the fire? Good grief. Julian had stumped me. I had no idea what the answer was. I give up. It's very simple. Place the letter amongst the dry wood and hold the magnifying glass over it. The rays of the sun will be focused so as to ignite the fire within a matter of seconds. And what about the can of tuna? Oh, I just threw that in to distract you from the obvious solution, Julian replied with a smile. But the essence of the example is this: putting the letter over the dry wood would produce no result. Yet the second you use the magnifying glass to concentrate the scattered rays of the sun onto the latter, it will ignite. This analogy holds true for the mind. When you concentrate its tremendous power on definite, meaningful objectives, you will quickly ignite the flames of your personal potential and produce startling results. Like what? I asked, only you can answer this question. What is it that you are searching for? Do you want to be a better father and live a more balanced, rewarding life? Do you desire more spiritual fulfillment? It is adventure and fun that you feel you are lacking. Give it some thought. How about eternal happiness? Go big or stay home, he chuckled. Nothing like starting off small, where you can have that too. How the sages of Sivana have known the secret of happiness for over 5,000 years. Fortunately, they were willing to share this gift with me. Do you want to hear it? No, I thought I would take a break and go wallpaper the garage first. Oh, of course, I want to hear the secret of eternal happiness, Julian. Isn't that what everyone is searching for ultimately? True, well, there it is. Could I trouble you for another cup of tea? Come on, quiet, Starling. All right, the secret of happiness is simple. Find out what you truly love to do and then direct all of your energy towards doing it. If you study the happiest, healthiest, most satisfied people of our world, you will see that each and every one of them has found their passion in life and then spent their days pursuing it. This calling is almost always one that in some way serves other. Once you are concentrating your mind, power and energy on a pursuit that you love, abundance flows into your life and all your desires are fulfilled with ease and grace. So simply figure out what turns you on and then do it. If it is a worthy pursuit, Julian replied. How do you define worthy? As I said, John, your passion must in some way improve or serve the lives of others. Viktor Frankl said it more elegantly than I ever could when he wrote, success like happiness cannot be pursued. It must ensure, and it only does so as the unintended side effect of one's personal dedication to a cause greater than oneself. Once you find out what your life's work is, your world will come alive. You will wake up every morning with a limitless reservoir of energy and enthusiasm. As your thoughts will be focused on your definite objective, you won't have time to waste time. Valuable mental power will therefore not be wasted on trifling thoughts. You will automatically erase the worthy habit and become far more effective and productive. Interestingly, you will also have a deep sense of inner harmony as if you are somehow being guided to realize your mission. It is a wonderful feeling. I love it, Julian offered gleefully. Fascinating, and I like the part about getting up feeling good. To be really honest with you, Julian, most days I wish I could just stay under the covers. I would be so much better than facing the traffic, the energy client, the angry clients, the aggressive opponents, and the ceaseless flow of negative influences. It all makes me feel so tired. Do you know why most people sleep so much? Why? Because they really don't have anything else to do. Those who rise with the sun all have one thing in common: insanity. Very funny. No. They all have a purpose that fans the flames of their inner potential. They are driven by their priorities, but not in an unhealthy, obsessive way. It is more effortless and gentle than that, and given their enthusiasm and love for what they are doing in their lives, such people live in the moment. Their attention is fully and completely on the task at hand, therefore they are no energy leaks. These people are the most vibrant and vital individuals you will ever have the good fortune to meet. Energy leaks sounds a little new agey. Julian, I will bet you didn't learn that one at Harvard Law School. True, the sages of Sivana pioneered that concept So it has been around for centuries. Its application is just as relevant today as it was when it was first developed. Too many of us are consumed by needless and endless worry. This drains us of our natural vitality and energy. Have you ever seen the inner tube of a bicycle tire? Of course, when it is fully inflated, it can easily take you to your destination, but if there are leaks in it, the tube eventually deflates, and your energy comes to an abrupt end. This is also how the mind works. Worry causes your precious mental energy and potential to leak, just like air leaking out of an inner tube. Soon you have no energy left. All of your creativity, optimism, and motivation has been drained, leaving you exhausted. I know the feeling. I often spend my days in the chaos of crisis. I have to be everywhere at once, and I can't seem to please anyone on those days. I notice that even though I have done very little physical labor, all my worrying leaves me totally deflated. By the end of the day, about the only thing I can do when I get home is pour myself a scotch and cuddle up with the remote control. Exactly too much stress does this to you. Once you find your purpose, however, life becomes much easier and far more rewarding when you figure out what your main aim or destiny really is. You will never have to work another day in your life. Early retirement, no, said Julian in the no-nonsense tune he had mastered during his days as an eminent lawyer. Your work will be play. Wouldn't it be a little risky for me to give up my job to start searching for my overriding passion and purpose? I mean, I have a family and real obligations. I have four people who depend on me. I am not saying you that have to leave the legal profession tomorrow. You will, however, have to start taking risks. Shake up your life a bit. Get rid of the cobwebs. Take the road less traveled. Most people live within the confines of their comfort zone. Yogi Raman was the first person to explain to me that the best thing you can do for yourself is regularly move beyond it. This is the way to lasting personal mastery and to realize the true potential of your human endowments. And what might those be? Your mind, your body, and your soul. So what risk should I take? Stop being so practical. Start doing the things you have always wanted to do. I have known lawyers who have quit their jobs to become stage actors and accountants who have become jazz musicians. In the process, they have found the deep happiness that had eluded them for so long. So what if they could no longer afford two vacations a year and a posh summer home in the Caymans? Calculated risk-taking will pay huge dividends. How will you ever get to third base with one foot on second? I see your point, so take the time to think. Discover your real reason for being here, and then have the courage to act on it. With due respect, Julian, all I do is think. As a matter of fact, part of my problem is that I think too much. My mind never stops. It is filled with mental chatter. It drives me crazy sometimes. What I am suggesting is different. The sages of Sivana all took time daily to silently contemplate not only where they were, but where they were going. They took the time to reflect on their purpose and how they were living with their dreams. Every day, most importantly, they thought deeply and genuinely about how they would improve the next day Daily incremental improvements produce lasting results, which in turn lead to positive change. So I should take the time to reflect on my life regularly. Yes, even 10 minutes of focused reflection a day will have a profound impact on the quality of your life. I understand where you are coming from, Julian. The problem is once my day gets cranking, I can't even find 10 minutes to eat lunch. My friend saying that you don't have time to improve your thoughts and your life is like saying you don't have time to stop for gas because you are too busy driving. Eventually, it will catch up with you. Yeah, I know. Hey, you were going to share some techniques with me, Julian. I said hoping to learn some practical ways to apply the wisdom I was hearing. There is one technique for mastering the mind which towers above all the rest. It is a favorite of the sages of Sivana who taught it to me with great faith and trust. After practicing it for only 21 days, I felt more energetic, enthusiastic, and vibrant than I had felt in years. The practice is over 4,000 years old. It is called the Heart of the Rose. Tell me more. All that you need to perform this exercise is a fresh rose and a silent place. Natural surroundings are best, but a quiet room will also do nicely. Start to stare at the center of the rose, its heart. Yogi Raman told me that a rose is very much like life. You will meet thorns along the way, but if you have faith and believe in your dreams, you will eventually move beyond the thorns into the glory of the flower. Keep staring at the rose, notice its color, texture, and design, savor its fragrance, and think only about this wonderful object in front of you. At first, other thoughts will start entering your mind, distracting you from the heart of the rose. This is the mark of an untrained mind, but you need not worry. Improvement will come quickly. Simply return your attention to the object of your focus. Soon your mind will grow strong and disciplined. That's all there is to it. It sounds pretty easy. That is the beauty of it, John, Julian replied. However, this ritual must be performed daily for it to be effective. For the first few days, you will find it difficult to spend even 5 minutes in this exercise. Most of us live at such a frenetic pace that true stillness and silence is something foreign and uncomfortable. Most people hearing my words will say that they have no time to sit and stare at a floor. These are the same people that will tell you that they have no time to enjoy the laughter of children or to walk barefoot in the rain. These people say they are too busy to do such things. They don't even have time to build friendships, for friendships also take time. You know a lot about such people. I was one of them, said Julian. He then paused and sat still. His intense gaze riveted on the grandfather clock. My grandfather had given Jenny and I as a housewarming present. When I think of those who live their lives this way, I remember the words of an old British novelist whose work my father loved to read. One must not allow the clock and the calendar to blind him to the fact that each moment of life is a miracle and a mystery. Persist and spend longer and longer periods savoring the heart of the rose, Julian continued in his throaty tone. After a week or two, you should be able to perform the technique for 20 minutes without your mind wandering on to other subjects. This will be your first indication that you are taking back control of the fortress of your mind. It will then focus only on what you Command it to focus on. It will then be a wonderful servant, able to do extraordinary things for you. Remember, either you control your mind or it controls you. Practically speaking, you will notice that you will feel far calmer. You will have taken a significant step towards erasing the worry about that plagues most of the population, and you will enjoy more energy and optimism. Most importantly, you will also observe a sense of joyfulness entering your life, along with an ability to appreciate the many gifts that surround you. Each day, no matter how busy you get and how many colleagues you might face, return to the heart of the rose. It is your oasis. It is your silent retreat. It is your island of peace. Never forget that there is power in silence and stillness. Stillness is the stepping stone to connecting with the universal source of intelligence that throbs through ever living thing. I was fascinated by what I had heard. Could it really be possible to profoundly improve the quality of my life with such a simple strategy? There must be more to the dramatic changes I see in you than the heart of the rose, I wondered aloud. Yes, this is true. In fact, my transformation came about as a result of using a number of highly effective strategies in concert. Don't worry, they are all just as simple as the exercise I have just shared with you, and equally as powerful. The key for you, John, is to open your mind to your potential for living a life rich with possibilities. Julian, ever the fountain of knowledge, continued to reveal what he had learned in Sivana. Another particularly good technique for riding the mind of worry and other negative life-draining influences is based on what Yogi Raman called opposition thinking. I learned that under the grand laws of nature, the mind can only hold one thought at any one time. Try it yourself, John. You will see that it is true. I did try it, and it is true. Using this little known information, anyone can easily create a positive creative mindset within a short period. The process is straightforward when a undesirable thought occupies the focal point of your mind. Immediately replace it with a uplifting one. It's as if your mind is a giant slide projector, with every thought in your mind being a slide. Whenever a negative slide comes up on the screen, take swift action to replace it with a positive one. This is where the prayer beads around my neck come in. Julian added with rising enthusiasm, every time I catch myself thinking a negative thought, I take this necklace off and remove another bead. These beads of worry go into a cup I keep in my knapsack. Together, they serve as gentle reminders that I still have a distance to travel on the road to mental mastery and responsibility over the thoughts that fill my mind. Hey, that's a great one. This is really practical stuff. I have never heard anything quite like it. Tell me more about this philosophy of opposition thinking. Here's a real life example. Let's say you have had a tough day in court. The judge disagreed with your interpretation of the law. The litigator on the other side belonged in a cage, and your client was more than a little annoyed with your performance. You come home and fall into your favorite chair full of gloom. Step one is to become aware that you are thinking these uninspiring thoughts. Self-knowledge is the stepping stone to self-mastery. Step two is to appreciate once and for all that just as easily as you allowed those gloomy thoughts to enter, you can replace them with cheerful ones. So think of the opposite of gloom. Concentrate on being cheerful and energetic. Feel that you are happy. Perhaps you might even start to smile. Move your body as you do when you are joyful and full of enthusiasm. Sit up straight, breathe deeply, and train the power of your mind on positive thoughts. You will notice a remarkable difference in the way you feel within minutes. Even more importantly, if you keep up your practice of opposition thinking, applying it to every negative thought that habitually visits your mind, within weeks you will see that they no longer hold any power. Do you see what I am getting at? Julian continued his explanation. Thoughts are vital living things, little bundles of energy, if you will. Most people don't give any thought to the nature of their thoughts, and yet the quality of your thinking determines the quality of your life. Thoughts are just as much a part of the material world as the lake you swim in or the street you walk on. Weak minds lead to weak actions. A strong, disciplined mind, which anyone can cultivate through daily practice, can achieve miracles. If you want to live life to the fullest, care for your thoughts as you would your most prized possessions. Work hard to remove all inner turbulence. The rewards will be abundant. I never saw thoughts as living things, Julian, I replied, amazed at this discovery, but I can see how they influence every element of my life, of my world. The sages of Simana firmly believe that one should only think sattvic or pure thoughts. They arrived at such a state through the techniques I have just shared with you, along with other practices such as natural diet, the repetition of positive affirmations or mantras, as they call them, reading books rich with wisdom, and by constantly ensuring that their company was enlightened. If even one impure thought entered the temple of their minds, they would punish themselves by traveling many miles to an imposing waterfall and standing under the ice-cold water until they could no longer bear the frigid temperature. I thought you told me these sages were wise, standing under an ice-cold waterfall deep in the Himalayan mountains of thinking. One little negative thought strikes me as extreme behavior. Julian was lightning fast in his response. The result of his many years as a world-class legal warrior. John, I will be blunt. You truly cannot afford the luxury of even one negative thought. Really, really, a worrisome thought is like an embryo. It starts off small but grows and grows. Soon it takes on a life of its own. Julian sobbed for a moment and then smiled. Sorry if I seem a little evangelistic when I speak on this subject, on the philosophy I learned on my journey. It's just that I have discovered tools that can improve the lives of many people, people who feel unfulfilled, uninspired, and unhappy. A few adjustments in their daily routines, to include the heart of the rose technique and a constant application of opposition thinking, will give them the lives they want. I think they deserve to know this before I move from the garden to the next element of Yogi Raman's mystical fable. I must let you know of one more secret which will offer you great aid in your personal growth. This secret which will offer you great aid in your personal growth, this secret is based on the ancient principle that everything is always created twice, first in the mind and then in reality. I have shared already that thoughts are things, material messengers that we send out to influence our physical world. I have also informed you that if you hope to make remarkable improvements in your outer world, you must first start within and change the caliber of your thoughts. The sages of Simana had a wonderful way to ensure that their thoughts were pure and wholesome. This technique was also highly effective in manifesting their desires. However simple into reality, the method will work for anyone. It will work for a young lawyer who seeks financial abundance just as it will work for a mother seeking a richer family life, or a salesperson seeking to close more sales. The technique was known to the sages as the secret of the lake. To apply it, these teachers would rise at 4 a.m. as they felt that the early morning possessed magical qualities from which they could benefit. The sages would then travel along a series of steep and narrow mountain paths which eventually led them to the lower reaches of the region they inhabited. Once there, they would walk along a barely visible trail lined with magnificent pine trees and exotic flowers until they arrived at a clearing. At the edge of the clearing was an aqua blue lake covered by thousands of tiny white lotuses. The water of the lake was strikingly still and calm. It was truly a miraculous sight. The sages told me that this lake had been a friend to their ancestors over the ages. What was the secret of the lake? I asked impatiently. Julian explained that the sages would look into the waters of the still lake and envision their dreams becoming reality. If it was the virtue of discipline they wished to cultivate within their lives, they would picture themselves getting up at dawn, performing the rigorous physical regimen without fail and spending days in silence to enhance their willpower. If it was more joy they were seeking, they would look into the lake and envision themselves laughing uncontrollably or smiling each time they met one of their brothers or sisters. If it was courage they desired, they would picture themselves acting with strength in the moment of crisis and challenge. Yogi Ramman once told me that as a boy, he lacked confidence as he was smaller than the other boys his age. While they were kind and gentle to him given their environmental influences, he grew insecure and shy. To cure this weakness, Yogi Ramman would travel to this heavenly spot and use the lake as a picture screen for images of the person he hoped to be. Some days he would visualize himself as a strong leader, standing tall and speaking with a powerful, commanding voice. Other days he would see himself as he wished to be when he grew older, a wise sage filled with tremendous inner strength and character, all the virtues he wished to have in his life. He first saw on the surface of the lake. Within a matter of months, Yogi Ramman became the person whom he mentally saw himself becoming. You see, John, the mind works through pictures. Pictures affect your self-image, and your self-image affects the way you feel, act, and achieve. If your self-image tells you that you are too young to be a successful lawyer or too old to change your habits for the better, you never will achieve these goals. If your self-image tells you that life rich with purpose, excellent health, and happiness are only for people from backgrounds other than your own, this prophecy will ultimately become your reality. But when you run inspiring, imaginative pictures through the movie screen of your mind, wonderful things start to happen in your life. Einstein said that imagination is more important than knowledge. You must spend some time every day, even if it is just a few minutes, in the practice of creative envisioning. See yourself as you want to be, whether this means serving as a great judge, a great father, or a great citizen of your community. Do I have to find a special lake to apply the secret of the lake? I asked innocently. No, the secret of the lake was simply the sage's name for the ageless technique of using positive image to influence the mind. You can practice this method in your own living room or even at the office if you really want to. Shut your door, hold all calls, and close your eyes. Then take a few deep breaths. You will notice that after 2 or 3 minutes, you will start To feel relaxed, next visualize mental pictures of all that you want to be, to have and to attain in your life. If you want to be the world's best father, envision yourself laughing and playing with your kids, responding to their questions with an open heart. Picture yourself acting gracefully and lovingly in a tense situation. Mentally rehearse the way you will govern your actions when a similar scene unfolds on the canvas of reality. The magic of visualization can be applied to so many situations. You can use it to be more effective in court, to enhance your relationships, and to develop yourself spiritually. Consistent use of this method will also bring you financial rewards along with an abundance of material gain. If this is important to you, understand once and for all that your mind has magnetic power to attract all that you desire into your life. If there is a lack in your life, it is because there is a lack in your thoughts. Hold wonderful pictures in your mind. Even one negative image is poisonous to your mindset. Once you start to experience the joy this ancient technique brings, you will realize the infinite potential of your mind and begin to liberate the storehouse of ability and energy that currently sleeps within you. It was as if Julian was speaking a foreign tongue. I had never heard anyone speak of the magnetic power of the mind to attract spiritual and material abundance, nor had I ever heard anyone speak of the power of imaging and its profound effect on every aspect of one's world. Yet deep inside, I had faith in what Julian was saying. This was a man whose judgment and intellectual abilities were impeccable. This was a man who was internationally respected for his legal acumen. This was a man who had walked down the path I was now journeying along. Julian had found something on his odyssey to the east, that much was clear. Looking at his physical vitality, his obvious tranquility, seeing his transformation confirmed that I would be wise to listen to his advice. The more I thought about what I was hearing, the more sense it made. Surely the mind must have a great deal more potential than most of us are currently using. How else could mothers lift otherwise immovable cars to save their crying infants who had fallen underneath? How else could martial artists break stacks of bricks with one fell swoop of their hands? How else could the yogis of the East slow down their heartbeats at will or endure tremendous pain without blinking an eye? Maybe the real problem was within me and my lack of belief in the gifts that every being possesses. Perhaps this evening, sitting alongside a former millionaire lawyer turned monk of the Himalayas, was a sort of wake-up call for me to start making the most of my life. But doing these exercises at the office, Julian, I responded, my partners think I am strange enough as it is. Yogi Raman and all the kind sages with whom he lived often used a saying that had been passed down to them through the generations. It is my privilege to pass it on to you on what has become an important evening for both of us. If I may say so, the words are as follows. There is nothing noble about being superior to some other person. True nobility lies in being superior to your former self. All I am really getting at is that you want to improve your life and live with all that you deserve. You must run your own race. It doesn't matter what other people say about you. What is important is what you say to yourself. Do not be concerned with the judgment of others. As long as you know what you are doing is right, you can do whatever you want to do as long as it is correct. According to your conscience and your heart, never be ashamed of doing that which is right. Decide on what you think is good, and then stick to it, and for God's sake, never get into the petty habit of measuring your self-worth against other people's net worth. As Yogi Raman preached, every second you spend thinking about someone else's dreams, you take time away from your own. It was now 7 minutes past midnight. Remarkably, I didn't feel the least bit tired when I shared this with Julian. He smiled once again. You have learned yet another principle for enlightened living. For the most part, fatigue is a creation of the mind. Fatigue dominates the lives of those who are living without direction and dreams. Let me give you an example. Have you ever had an afternoon at the office where you were reading your dry case reports and your mind started to wander and you started to feel sleepy? From time to time, I answered, not wishing to reveal the fact that this was my modus operandi. Sure, most of us feel drowsy and work on a regular basis, yet if a friend calls on the phone to ask you if you want to go out to the ball game that night or asks you for advice on his golf game, I have no doubt that you would spring to life. Every trace of your fatigue would vanish. Is that a fair assessment? That's fair, counselor. Julian knew he was on a roll. So your tiredness was nothing more than a mental creation, a bad habit your mind has cultivated to act as a crutch. When you are performing a tedious task tonight, you are obviously enchanted with my story and keen to learn the wisdom that has been revealed to me. Your interest and mental focus give you energy. This evening your mind has not been in the past, nor has it been in the future. It has been squarely focused on the present, on our conversation. When you consistently direct your mind to live in the present, you will always have boundless energy, no matter what time the clock reflects. I nodded my head in agreement. Julian's wisdom seemed so obvious, and yet so much of it had never occurred to me. I guess common sense is not always so common. I thought about what my father used to tell me when I was growing up. Only those who seek shall find. I wish he was with me.